Hello everybody, this is Dr. Carlo Oyer, Medical Director here at Cartersville Medical Center in Cartersville, Georgia. This presentation is to officially state or declare a state of emergency in our emergency department. This presentation is being given on April 2015 here at Cartersville Medical Center in Georgia. Today, I, Dr. Carlo Oyer, emergency physician and the medical director for our emergency department, want to declare a state of emergency in regards to the perceptions of our patients to the care that we provide. Since I became director of this emergency department, our focus has been 90 to 100% metric driven to find ways to improve the efficiency and patient flow in regards to arrive to greet times, patients who leave without having the adequate medical care, length of stay of our patients, and people who elope after the care was initiated or they leave against medical advice. And our efforts have definitely paid off. We've seen a decrease in the left prior to medical screening exam rate from 3.5% to less than 0.3% and kept it at that low number for more than a year. Our arrival to greet times dropped from 67 minutes when I started with this hospital in 2011 to an average of 12 minutes last month to date. We've seen our admitted patients waiting to go to the floor wait be over 2 hours to an average of 35 minutes. Our eloped and AMA patients went from close to 6% last year or 2 years before to about 2.5% to 1% this month to date. We've also seen some major improvements in our lab turnaround times, thanks to the implementation mostly of ED phlebotomies. Currently, our average turnaround time for all major blood tests is under 50 minutes. Bottom line is, I can honestly say that, despite our challenges, I'm proud to say this is the most efficient emergency department I ever have the privilege to work at. So why am I declaring a state of emergency for our emergency department? Well, in 2015, we started the Press-Ganey as our patient experience survey method before we had Gallups and the data was really very poor. We're about to close this first quarter data on our Press-Ganey patient perception surveys. This is our current ranking on patient perception. Out of 166 facilities on the survey, we are 134th with our all Press-Ganey database percentile being in the 21st percentile. When we break it into not just in overall satisfaction, but breaking by nursing, by phlebotomies, by tests, by radiology, and everything else, the scores are varied. But you can see that the doctor scores in terms of percentile are way lower, as evidenced by that circle notifying or marking the four specific doctor questions. And doctors meaning doctors or mid-level provider like nurse practitioners and physician assistants, of course. You can see that we are way down. In the previous table, you saw we have some areas with better scores than others. Some of them are pretty decent. But out of all the areas surveyed, it is the question that assesses the medical providers that we score the lowest in. So let's look at those questions. You can see that overall for doctors, 77.5 is the mean. But the mean for all Press-Ganey database is 86%. That puts us at a ranking of 3 percentile, which is very, very poor. And then broken into the four questions, doctor's courtesy, time to listen, doctor reinformative about treatment, doctor's concern about comfort. You can see the scores are very, very poor. But then I added these two, how well was pain control, because that's mostly depending on what we order for pain and how we manage their pain while they're in the ER. We can see this is the 9th percentile, and overall rating of ER care, 12th percentile. And I put this in kind of like a speedometer kind of thing, you know, we want to be at 100, and currently this is where we're at, a ranking of 5 percentile for doctor courtesy. Doctors took time to listen, we're at ranking of 4th percentile. Doctors informative about retreatment, we're ranking of 3 percentile. And doctors concerned for comfort, ranking 2nd percentile. I summarize all this data up to date in these 4, 5, 6 circles. Overall ranking of the ER, pain control and home care education, and the four doctor-specific questions. My goal is that we'll be on the 90th percentile, of course. I mean, we should strive for excellence in everything we do. But that's hard to do. It's hard to move that dial up, and this is what the discussion is about. This is why I want to declare a state of emergency. According to the data we collected, it's mixed. It's doctors and mid-level providers. But the bottom line is that out of all the different processes in the ER, we are the ones who are dragging the ER scores down. This is very embarrassing to admit, but we need to put our efforts not in improving the good to very good, but to decrease the numbers of fair, poors, and very poors. Most emergency departments actually work on making goods into very good, and that's how they improve their overall percentiles. But we have close to 20% on each of these metrics that are very poor, poor, and fair scores. And we need to work on these people who are very unsatisfied with the care. What we need is damage control. Most emergency departments trying to fix their prescreening scores, what they work in is turning the goods into very goods. But we need to work on the 24% of people who rate us fair, poor, and very poor, and turn them into good and very good. So, by this point in the presentation, if you're not feeling a deep sense of embarrassment or sadness, then I'm not sure you should be part of our team or that you should work in our emergency department. You should feel a deep sense of commitment to our facility to the point that you feel like, man, this is truly an emergency. We need to do something about it. So first thing I want to say about patient experience is that this is not just one more thing. This is really how people are seeing the care that you provide to our patients. This is the outcome, the final measure of how well we did with caring for our patients. Sure, we fixed the broken ankle, but if they went home with a perception of unhappiness, of not being satisfied with the care, then did we really do what we are set out to do? So this picture here, empathy, is to really start with the basics, to put yourselves in the patient's shoes, to go into each room thinking, that's my wife, that's my son, that's my mom, my dad, this is my neighbor, my friend, my pastor at church. You know, think of them as your own and treat them as you would like to be treated. This is pretty basic, but this is where we need to start. Just a deep sense of empathy. And remember, they are not medical providers. They don't know that this is not an emergency. They don't know that this is nothing urgent. They're here because they're worried about their health and about what's going on with them. So there are three or four things that I really want to focus this year to improve our patient experience scores. I mean, we could try 100 different things, but these four things are things that are expectations that every single provider, advanced practice providers included, will do every single time when we care for our patients. Number one is, this slide right here, is utilize the whiteboard. Going through a very personal thing with my wife and her illness, the utilization of the whiteboard was so huge to my satisfaction, to my perception of the caring that she received, that they care enough to write their names on the board to keep me updated as to what was going on, what was the next step, what tests were missing, what labs were pending, that really that whiteboard became like epiphany, an opening of my eyes of thinking, wow, if I'm on the other side, I want that board updated. I want to have current data on what's going on. So I want everybody in the department to utilize the board, not just to make sure the name is written on the board, but to really utilize the plan of care options, to circle, you're ordering labs, you're ordering x-rays, you're ordering labs, and so on. To utilize the pain scale, to circle, to move the circle once the patient's pain is better. And this is a way to prove that we're doing what we're doing. Remember, we are also doing patient roundings to make sure that these practices are happening and that we are doing these things. Second thing, this picture shows two things. Number one, providers sitting at the bedside. I know you've heard this a million times, the patient's perception is better. If you're sitting down, they think you spend more time. But you know what? Out of all the providers who saw me in the hospital with my wife, none of the professionals, doctors or APPs sat down at the bedside. None of them did. And I don't think that that would have made me think higher of them, but it would have made me think that they cared more. And it's not a matter if they spend more time or not. It's just made me feel like they care enough to sit down and give me the time. So it really changed me in terms of what it really means to that patient that we actually sat at the bedside to talk to them. Number two, if you can see in the picture, is that they actually show him that they're writing some things down or they have some lab work pulled up. That's something that I've changed in my own practice. I'm hitting the print summary button when I go to talk to patients and discharge them, so I can go and show them and discuss with them the blood work, not out of memory and trying to recollect if their potassium or sodium was normal, but actually showing them what the actual result was and then giving that copy to the patient so they can take home something that they can touch and feel that evidences that I sat down and discussed the results with the patient. I even print in copies of the x-rays, anything relevant, I'm just printing. Yes, sure, they have patient care access, they can look it up themselves, but just the act of giving it has to improve the perception. It just has to. And these are two things that I want to comment on in this picture. Is number one, right before you open that door to get out, or right before you get out of that room, to turn around and ask the patient and family, is there anything else that you need right now? Is there anything else I can do for you? Or do you have any more questions? Giving that moment of stopping, turning around and asking that, it really meant a lot, because almost every, I wouldn't say every single time the providers were at the hospital, they did it. But I would say 90-something percent of the time, the staff at the hospital my wife was in, they stopped and asked me that question. And it meant a lot to me that they did. A lot of times I did have things that I needed, but I didn't want to bother them, so I said I didn't need anything. And number two, the second picture there is that it's not just to come in and out. You see the patients kind of rushing in and out of rooms. If you're going to spend 5 minutes with that patient, instead of spending the whole 5 minutes at once, it would be best to spend 2 minutes, 1 minute, and another minute here. You know, if you spend it multiple revisits, and that's how I've changed my practice, to not just see my face once, but to see it twice, three times. You know, if it's an admitted patient, two or three times. If it's a discharge patient, two or three times. If it's a quick fast track, then maybe it's just the one time. But definitely make the point of turning around, asking if they need anything else, any more questions. More face contact, but more times, rather than just total time, more times that I came back to the room to talk to them. Here I'd like to make reference to two videos that I wish that you would go and spend some time watching. They're made by the Cleveland Hospital. It's called the Cleveland's Empathy Series. And it talks about patients' perception, and it's really, really enlightening how they developed the video. Very professionally well made, and I just think that every provider should take the time to look at these videos, and the links are here. This is an email I got from the CEO of our hospital on April 9th. Good morning. I wanted to let you know that Bridget, she's our CNO, and I were on a division call this morning with all facilities from division student coaching team. The attached results were shared and reviewed, showing the progress. We continue to make facility-wide in our patient experience results as measured by Prescani. I'm really pleased and proud of the continuous efforts and focus that you and your teams are providing to make sure our patients, our families, have positive experience at Cartersville Medical Center. This is confirmed by the many positive comments we're hearing in the community on a regular basis. We have made and are continuing to make progress, and of course, there's opportunity for us to continue to improve, and I know we will. Keep up the great work, and thank you for your and your colleagues for their efforts. Please feel free to share with your teams. So this is a great feedback that we are actually improving from the first month we started collecting data to the end of the first quarter, and even comparing the first quarter to the beginning of the second quarter and how we're doing. You can see on most of those measures, they're actually a little bit better and the percentiles are actually improving. Me as the medical director, I am going to really take advantage of the student group coaching and what they're asking us to do, and the suggestions that are putting in place to really improve. I want to come out of this saying I fought a good fight and we did our best. That we are going to try to utilize these tools, the whiteboards, discussions at the bedside with lab work printed out, stopping before I leaving the room and saying, is there anything else you need? and trying to make more face contact with the patient, meaning multiple revisits to the patient. I believe if we all use this consistently, our scores should get better. Of course, courtesy and respect, informative about revisits. We know the questions that are going to be asked to our patients. And we know that they're almost 100% of patients who are discharged are getting this. Not all of them are responding to them. Not all of them are sending in the data. So it is there is a pretty considerable collection bias. But this is what we have, and this is what we're being compared to everybody else. And bottom line is, you know, if patients are not perceiving a good experience, not a good care, not just the medical part of it, but the whole, the entirety of it, then we fail at what we're doing. And I want you guys to get on board with me. I want us to, by the end of this year, maybe have a target goal, 50th percentile. Be right at the middle. Definitely be, in the next 2-3 months, be right there with everybody else in the department, because they have higher percentiles than we do, the physicians and medical providers. By the end of this year, to be at the 50th percentile on different scores. And hopefully by next year, we'll be in the 80th and 90th percentile. And how are we going to do this? Is by utilizing these tools from the Studer Group, by using these four deliberate actions we're going to do with every patient: the whiteboards, the discussion about blood work results at the bedside, sitting down, asking if the patient needs anything else, and multiple revisits to the patient. Never discharge a patient who would haven't had a discharge sit-down discussion with them. And from the Studer Group, from my side, is to make sure that you actually are doing the things that you say you're doing. So I'm going to be doing some patient rounding to document and evidence whether or not my providers are doing these behaviors that are expectations of the department, of me, that I expect you, the providers, to be doing. So I hope that this has been an eye-opening presentation for you, that you take this seriously and to heart, and that you come out your next shift wanting to make the scores the very best they can be. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.